제가 이번 학기에 여러분들의 출석이나 이런 것들을 감상하게 될 겁니다.
Life in Germany. So I lived in Germany and Switzerland. No, I never lived in Switzerland. Japan, I did part of my studies in Japan, just a little bit, but quite important. And I'll come back to that for one of the pieces that I'll be talking about. So yes, Japan, Finland, yeah, another piece in Finland, Denmark. And the Swedish people, we love to hate or make tease and make fun of the Danish. And even more so the Norwegian. And France. So France in ninth place. And I lived in France for 9 years. So I have Israel. I've never been to Israel. But I thought this was quite a nice list, and I thought I can like take five or six of these top 10 countries. I was quite happy. So does it mean that you guys are very innovative? Does it mean that I'm innovative? What does innovation mean in music today? What does it mean for Korean instruments? Because I think you're all specialists, right? Yeah? I hope I got that right. Who is not a specialist in the Korean instrument? Can you show me a hand? No, you're all specialists. I want to check out a few other things with you guys here. Who's in the undergraduate program? Can you show me a hand? Okay. Who's in the graduate program? Oh, nobody? Graduate? Yeah. You're all in the graduate program? Oh, so show me your hand. One. Graduate program, master, PhD, DMA, if you're in that program, no? Okay, you can hesitate there. Who plays the gagam? Show me your hand. Okay, one, two, three. Who plays the piri? Who plays the gayagam? Oh, many people. Best things. What else do we have? There's many others. See, I'm learning these things. I knew before coming here. I knew the. That was it. So I have a lot of things to learn. Do you help me? Anyhow, so. As I mentioned, I'm born in Sweden, and I studied actually in Norway, here at the Oslo Academy. That's where I did my bachelor in composition. Before that, I did studies in mathematics. And so I'm sort of a little bit late, if you can see this list. I think you are, who is above 30, hands up? If you're more than 30 years old, nobody. Who's above 25? Hands up. I see somebody scratching his nose. Maybe not 25. Who is above 20? So maybe most people are between 20 and 25. Who's younger than 20? Anybody younger than 20? No? Okay, ask your friend sitting next to you, and if your friend is younger than 20, that's a hands up. Okay, nobody. Everybody between 20 and 25. Well, when I was your age, I was doing my undergraduate, but as I mentioned, I was doing a bit of mathematics, and then I switched to first a piano performance, which is 1 year, and then I did composition. So I sort of moved between these disciplines, and it meant that it took a little bit of time for me to finish these things, but it's okay. Then I went to France, as I mentioned, for 9 years. I worked as a composer. I did 2 degrees after that. Then I started working, teaching composition, electroacoustic composition in France, and that was 2005. But in the mid-2007, I moved to Singapore with my wife. She's Singaporean. And so I've been working there for about 10 years. I was also back in Sweden for a while to finish my PhD. Yeah, so you see it's sort of different countries and different degrees and where I've been working. Something like this. But maybe more important is those three words on top of that. So the, actually before that, acoustic words. And then I did interactive words. So and that is really when you have an acoustic instrument and a computer. Then I did more multimedia works. So for stage, for film, for installation. And in particular, installation has really kept me busy more recently. So sound installation, multimedia installations. What's in the next slide? I don't know. Huh. So it's kind of the well, this is where it started. So I played the piano when I was a kid, from very young. Maybe I'm how old am I here? 10, 11, 12, something like this. So up to that point, I was just playing classical music, and I was quite good, but not fantastic. Okay, so. At 12, 13, I sort of quit playing classical music, and I started to play the trombone, which is my trombone, and I played in different orchestras, and marching bands, and jazz. So jazz became quite important for me, also on playing piano, and then eventually synthesizers and playing you know, bands at school, rock bands, fusion jazz bands, and many such things. So that was really what I did during my teen years. And then I went to university to do mathematics. But then I figured out, mathematics is, you know, it's great. It's really, I really love it. But you're missing something. Somehow I'm missing myself and the social, and the working with people. And I could do that in music. So I had a bit of a transition period there, and before I decided, oh no, I should go for music after all. Never regretted it. But because of these, this background, I think it's quite natural for me to work with computer music. And composition. Who here is actually doing composition? Anybody in the room? Yeah, some people doing composition. 1, 2, 3, 4 something. 4 people. But most of you are performers. And this is a very important relationship between performers and composers. And some people are doing a bit of both, which is, I think, how should I say, very stimulating. But it's also hard to keep it up, it really is. But when you're students, you know, you can nurture these kind of relationships between performer and composer, and you work together onto creating something new. That can be very important for your future career. So today I want to talk about acoustic and electronic, and I'll show you two pairs of pieces. And then I want to continue and talk about sort of a more recent perspective for me, which is between soundscape and sonification. So I'll talk a bit about that, and then after I will spend spend some time on introducing to you the three courses that I'm giving, so electroacoustic composition, music for multimedia, and mixed music. Okay, that's the flashiest thing you can see from the keynote. Korean instruments. So we're developing a new course, and it's really meant for you as performers, composer performers. We'll come back to that. Okay, and we have, ample time for questions and answers. So, first topic, let's think about this one for a while, an acoustic and electronic. So, the picture of me again, but yeah, I'm a little bit old. I'm sort of the same age as what I imagine that you would be. I think I'm around 25 in this picture. I don't want to tell you guys that I wasn't always this old, you know? Maybe you think your professors, they just sort of live in a closet and they come out and they go back into the closet. But I was also an undergrad. I was also having all these points in life that I have to decide which way am I going to go, what am I really going to spend my time on, or maybe I just want to waste time, which I also did. But I want to share with you this piece here. I looked at this, you know, during the weekend when I was planning these pages. The piece is called Eight Poems for a Vocalist and a Flute Player. This is a piece that I haven't listened to. I mean, it's 24 years old, this piece, you know? It's from 95. That's really old. This is one piece. I haven't listened to this piece or looked at the score for, I don't know, so long time. But when I look back at it, and I realize that actually it's quite good. And I was so proud of myself. And I think it has always been one of the pieces which were most transformative for me as a composer. I think you know that experience. Okay, so the poems here, they tell a story about love and betrayal. You know what betrayal is? That's like bad love when your boyfriend or girlfriend dumps you for somebody else or for some stupid reason. So that's betrayal. So that's in the poems. I studied some Japanese at the time, and so I read poetry. Tantai has very short forms, so it's just a few words, but very intricate. And then I translated them, of course, to Swedish or English or French. But I also translated them into something like a synthetic language. So it's a made-up language, but it's consistent. But I was really interested in the sounds of this synthetic language. I was imagining a place, some other place, you know, a utopia, where people living in this place, they don't use their vocal cord. Maybe they don't even have any vocal cord. Maybe they just whisper. That's what they do. But it's very excited sometimes. It's a very heightened form of whispering. And that was the mode I was interested in, and it sort of fitted with Japanese culture, Japanese shakuhachi music, and also my own life, of course. It's a true story. I'm going to play you a little bit of this piece, if I do like this. This is just 2 minutes from this piece. And I have the score. I will show you the score. Actually, my this score was a bit lost in a storage. My daughter helped me late last night, so she dug it out and took some pictures and photos of the score. You see here it's handwritten and so forth. Why don't we follow it? So it's a little bit, you see the coffee stains, a little bit of this quarter. But we can have this and then we listen to 2 minutes from this piece. It's going to start here. The same excerpt actually, it was the second poem, and I think a little bit more in this other version. Thank you. not exactly a reverb either. It's a particular kind of filter process that we call the modulus by extended corpus strong. And you can imagine that the flute player is sort of playing her sounds into a string. But this string, we can change the material properties of it, or mathematical properties of it, so that it resembles that of some other material, some particular material. Let's say a string that is made of glass, or a string that is made of wood. Now, that doesn't exist in real life, but we can put those numbers into the signal processing, and then we get a particular kind of filtering which resembles a kind of a reverberation. So that's what I was after in this piece here. Next slide. I use this principle many times for different pieces, and one of them is called telegraphie. I think I have an example, but I don't know. Well, I played it. See if I can catch up. So here we have a voice, a percussion, is a cymbal, and a piano. So good. You will pay attention right here. It's also Tuesday, and it's part of this Tuesday afternoon. Maybe it's like this, I don't know. Anyhow, it's going to be here, and I will present three bigger pieces and then four sort of interludes in between. Telegraphy is one of them. And I call it, I think I'm going to call it, but I'm not sure, site specific utopias. Is of course an oxymoron, but I've been interested in utopias and the pieces they refer to that as well. site-specific course combined plans. I want to show you the other pair of pieces, which is I made it when I was a little bit older. I was like 34. Mao variations and Mao Torica. Mao, who is Mao? What is Mao? Mao, you know Mao? You know China? Tongo, you know China? Who created modern China? Who was the father of modern China? Has his face on all the bills or money? It's Mao Zedong, huh? Mao Zedong. This? What does that mean? Well, okay. Here we have a picture of Mao Zedong. And he has like, you know what those things are? The white sticks? Looks like a V sign, but it's actually his brushes, his calligraphy brushes. Now, Mao Zedong wasn't really a very multifaceted, very complicated person, and of course, a dictator, and he did many, you can say, wrong things or crazy things, for sure. He also managed to do some quite amazing and good things, like lifting 200 million Chinese out of extreme poverty into bearable middle class. He was extremely interested in poetry and in Chinese calligraphy, when you write poetry with particular gestures. And he sort of used this in the way that he was doing politics as well. I was fascinated by Chinese 20th century history during this time, so I read biographies on Mao and so forth. Anyhow, I've written, I think, 5 or 6 pieces, which are all based on recordings of his speeches, of his voice. And here's one of them, or two of them, actually. So it's the Mao Variations, which is a piece for a trio, an acoustic trio. And then the other one, I call it Mao Torica, Torica like rhetorics, art of speaking. But I'd like to compare between this acoustic trio and the electro-acoustic piece for loudspeakers. Okay. Okay, we'll stop there. So that was just a short excerpt from one of his speeches from 1956, I believe. And so I transcribed that, his speech. And here's the start of the Mao Variations. Temporal changes, and you can translate here's the continuation of that. Synthesis does, if you come to my classes in electroacoustic composition, I'll show you all the details, but I'll just, you know, you have two sounds, and then you perform an analysis of them, which is called a Fourier transformation. So you essentially change from the time domain to the spectral domain. This is a spectral the name, representation of the sound here. And then you have two or three components. You have frequencies, amplitudes, you have phases, amplitude. So from the two different sounds. And then you can choose, you take a certain amount of the frequency information in one sound plus the frequency information in the other sound. And you mix them too, but you do that in the spectral domain. And then you have an output, and you perform the inverse Fourier transform on it, and you get back to the time domain, and you get a sound that you can listen to. You can change these parameters to find the kind of flavor that you're interested in. This is something that you can only do in a computer. Yeah. This is my new friend. His name is Eya. So he commissioned a piece from me. He's actually excellent. You should see his blog spots. You know, maybe he looks old, but he's super good at the computer. And he plays not exactly a Korean traditional instrument, but it's a Finnish traditional instrument called the kantele. Kantele. You know this instrument, kantele? You know the Hungarian zither? You know this instrument? Actually, with the zither, we have little mallets. But with this kantele, you will see it while you pluck the strings, but it has some of the same flavor. Yeah, I'm joking with you again. You guys are so easy to trick. I love this picture, but actually the person who commissioned me is this pretty girl from Finland. So that's Eya, and she plays. But I thought the two images show the depth of traditions 100 years apart. So this picture from 2006, and that one from 1916. So, okay, I'm gonna play you, just so you know this instrument. Supposed to This is the third part of the harmonic variations, and also the third part of the acoustic piece.
반주는 Keep that in mind, and I'll tell you another example that complements it. First, if you listen just the mouse original recording, you will, of course, they're made in the 1940s, 1950s, these recordings, and very noisy, it was a very narrow band, etc. So if you do a tidying up, can you appreciate that? That sort of all the noise is taken away if you compare with the. Yeah, that's a big difference, at least in my mind. But it also opens up the possibility that what if we just keep the noise? It sounds like this. That's whisper, right? That's whisper. That's this exaggerated. Utopian whisper again in the piece that I had done more than 10 years before this one. Okay, the ending. I used electroacoustic methods to sort of stretch it out and then to do a little waving transformation here. So you will recognize the ending bit from earlier. So what I hope to have been able to show you here is a process of working with the same material but in two different domains, the acoustic and the electronic. And sometimes with this overlap, right? Like in the telegraphy piece. Now I'm going to fly through, keep it much shorter. This is more of my
soundscape and sonification. So this led into my PhD work, which is very much about how soundscape relates to music and to speech, to art, to perception and design of an environment. Now, soundscape is a concept that I don't know if you're familiar with it. It was introduced by Armin Schaefer, and there's many people working with it now on a research level, and also composers who are doing soundscape compositions, as an accent song and others. Now Schaefer's idea was that we could, one of his ideas was that we can hear the everyday world. We walk out into the society and we listen to it, and we can train ourselves to hear that acoustic environment as a composed piece of music. And he really used the word music. Now, of course, I think that the inverse is also possible. We can design the soundscape in the same way that we compose a piece of music. Okay, so what I did for my research, I recorded lots of environments, and I sort of focused in onto restaurants. So I've spent so much time in restaurants in Singapore and in Stockholm. I've recorded, I've taken photos, I've made sound pressure level measurements, I've run surveys and listening tests back in laboratory on this. And just different way of doing field research and acoustic ecology. Things like this, you know, match a photo to the soundscape. So in a listening situation, you hear something and you know, you're supposed to guess which where this comes from. And people are pretty good at this. They're, I think, much better than what you might guess at first. It leads to publications like this one here. Acoustics. This is this field research with more than 100 restaurants in Singapore. But I was also working as a soundscape composer, as an artist, and I had traveling around. This one's from French Polynesia, which was amazing to be able to go to French Polynesia and recordings, ambisonics, underwater recordings. Fish, fish speaking with each other. This one, yeah. No. I want this one to move. Yes, see. Isn't that pretty? This is not an aquarium. It's very shallow. It's a reef, and there's no sound here. But I do record the sounds of the reef, fish, damsel fish. Parrot fish, they are very expressive. So it's one thing, and
yeah.
So this gentleman to the right here, we interviewed him, he's telling a story about the
reefs.
French Polynesia was 193 bombs. Crazy, huh? So of course this affects the whole environment. It's off limits for civilians still today. Anyhow, but we were traveling there with that focus. Okay, so sonification is a technique to translate environmental data into sounds. Using some kind of reproducible
synthesis. And it can be for both very pragmatic scientific purposes, but also for aesthetic purposes. So I've done different works with this, and the most important one is called Locus Graph, and it deals with weather data, climate data, as you can see from this map in the Southeast Asia region, both climate records going back 30, 40 years, and predictions for the future going all the way to the year 2099, going 80 years into the future. What would the weather be like? What about the sea levels? What about the temperature? What about the propensity for storms in this region? So it's all in the model. And then I take those data and I make it possible to hear that, to hear the future. That's the idea. So in this series of pieces, the interest is really to go from a smaller number of channels into a larger number of channels, so you have more immersivity, you have more detailed spatial resolution. So I work this with, I skip that, and I skip this one as well. We did a couple of shows, but I'll stay with this one here. I'll play with this presentation.
Perspective onto the line.
so that 4 days pass by every second.
Okay, so you can see that this piece of music was also part of a dance performance. The installation was actually running for 4 or 5 days, 4 days, and the dance performance came in on 3 times during the first day, 3 times during the second day. So they developed a choreography with this as a backdrop. But I want to say that the choreographer, she and her husband, who is a climate scientist, were absolutely instrumental for me to start working in this way, to start working with this data. So that's art exhibition in Singapore. Okay, well, I think we have pretty much come to the end of what I wanted to say about me, and I'm going to talk very quickly about the courses that I do here at SMU. So there's electric composition, music for multimedia, and mixed music, which is totally open for Korean instruments. And I've taken the opportunity to try to look into this repertory. But let's go to the web pages. So, not this one. Okay. I don't know if you can read what it says on the top line there, but we have the events. For example, the upcoming, starting tomorrow, there's 3 days of the SNU conference and workshop on contemporary music. So if you're around, come to the workshop, which is the workshop is tomorrow, and then there's one lecture on Thursday, one lecture on Friday, and there's concert on Thursday evening and Friday evening. So you're all welcome to this event. Just check these web pages for more information. Okay, so previous events we did, this one, highlight, maybe you saw it, 9-beat stretch. Did you see this one? Okay, let's play it. Do you remember it? Like 4 months ago, or too long time back? Anybody here who was singing in Beethoven's 9th Symphony? Ah, yes, I know you, of course. You're in the film, do you know that? Yeah.
And did you also see this? I mean, as I said, see this as an installation piece, of course, also hear it. It was in the lobby, right? So you could hardly miss it. It was running for 24 hours, all through the night, next day, whole day. So I think it's a very interesting piece of electroacoustic music that comes from acoustic music. So it shows this linkage again in Leithinger's piece. Now you also saw there at the end my good friend and colleague Kim Yong-san. Where are we? Courses, yes. And now I want to say something about mixed music. Yeah? Mixed music. So Yong-san and myself, we are starting this course now, next semester. We'll be running two parts, so one and two. But it is all about how do you perform and create a repertory for your instrument with electronics, with computer, with tape, with electronics. So we're going to look into, of course, if you can read here, it's pretty small. What is this mixed music? What's it mixed? It's a bebop of music, right? So hardware, how do we work with, how do you work with your instrument on miking, amplifying, creating the good reverberation for your performance? How do you do recording? Maybe a little bit, but not so much. Yong-san has another course which is very geared towards for you how to do good recordings of your performances. It's called media production. But in this course, it's about performance with technology. And in the first semester, we'll be focusing on what's called fixed media pieces. So we have performance, and then you have sound files to accompany. In the second semester, we're going to interactive music. We have a computer that is generating responses to the instrument. Okay, so I was... Mixed music with Korean instruments. ICMC 2018, you know, it was in Daegu, right? In the southern part of Korea. Daegu International Conference, International Computer Music Conference. So there were quite a few pieces for Korean instruments and electronics. I can show you examples. Then it says mint. That's what is it? Not sure. Okay. So mint at the University of Bali, which has a database. If you are interested in finding these pieces, these are the resources. Mint. I've started to do a YouTube playlist, so all the pieces that I can find, I've put them in a YouTube playlist. Maybe you will find that fun. So, just I listened to, I think, all of these pieces. So, Gaia Rabbit is a pretty cool piece. You know this one? How do you contact me, right? So on the business card it says my email address, you can take it down, you can always drop me an email. My office is in the 220 building, 220, 404. Knock on my door. If you're interested in this course, mixed music, you're interested in it, but you don't really know what's what, etc., just come and see me, speak with me. Speak with Professor Kim Young-sung, he's just, you know, in the same corridor, and we'll explain the details to you. Okay, here's my question. This is my question for you. Push the button up on like this.
I don't.
That's wonderful. Yeah, yeah.
This is my question and kind of answer that question. I think we notice electronic works on artificial intelligence and music or performing arts together. So I'm interested in artificial AI.
Really interesting, and thanks for bringing that up. AI has had such a boost in just the past 2-3 years. We have like AlphaZero, AlphaGo, Alpha, what's it called? Star Wars, Starcraft, Alpha Star, playing Starcraft, right? It's fantastic about AI. And they can also create paintings, music, maybe as well. AI. Are you scared? Well, many people say that we should be scared because AI is frightening stuff, especially for not just for people who are lifting boxes, who are doing manual labor, sorting mail in the post office. That's almost gone, right, as a profession, or in all the supply chain of food and goods, robots are doing so much of this work. But even professions such as lawyers, medical specialists, psychologists, X-ray analysts, these people would be replaced by AI in the near future. This is happening already. Now, I don't think anybody in this room is going to be a lawyer, but maybe you know your friends who are studying to be a lawyer. Ask them, speak with them. How do they relate to AI in their practice? Can they become better lawyers with the help of AI? Expert systems, legal tests. I think so, but I also think that in the future, so many things will change. We're talking about 10 years, 20, 30 years. What about musicians then? Will be replaced by AI? K-pop holograms. What do you think?
I think many things are changed in art, so because of AI.
Such as what?
Such as performing art or traditional art or
a little bit, but not so many things. I think basically the arts are very resistant to AI as a threat. And also because the innovative arts, including innovative music, have a facility of absorbing novelty, technological novelties, and ride on that. So, if you're part of that, then I think you have a shining future, professional future. Any other thoughts on this matter? Do you play some pop music on your instruments? You play these fusion bands, like crossover bands with electric bass and synths, maybe a singer, Kagan. You do these things? Or are you very strict for the repertory of fine traditional pieces? Do you think about these things? Do you like pop?
just, I know you are being exposed to these things. Of course, everybody is. But the question is, how do we absorb this? And we are also, to some extent, we're also carrying a tradition, which is a fantastic tradition. Hundreds of years, thousands of years of musical development. You have this responsibility to do something good with it, to do something sustainable with it. That's also a kind of environmental change that we are being exposed to. We have to live with that change. And I'm sure that you are very serious students about what you're doing, and I think that in 10 years from now, you would like to be playing, you would like to be professional musicians, you would have like a rich life with music, not rich as in money necessarily, but just a full life, many good things happen with your music. And I think you can all do that. It's possible. But I don't think it's easy. I don't think it's automatic at all. It's more difficult today than what it was 25 years ago. I was not quick enough 25 years ago. Any other thoughts? Okay, if not, then take note of my email and do drop me a line. Very nice to be here today. Thank you all. Thank you all.